I always think of the gopher in Caddyshack. He's got a good groove. Hey, good morning, everybody. Look, here's a quick Zoom for you. It's really important special effects today because I'm here hosting by myself this morning, except thank goodness I have a wonderful guest to keep me going. How you doing this morning, Nyla?
I am good. We're jamming. Nice, tranquil way to start. I can imagine I'm by a beach instead of this front yard that I've been looking at for the last 4 months.
Oh, man, yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, it's nice to just have a window, right? We have to take a little winds, right?
Like, so at least I have a window.
There you go, right? Yeah. So it could be worse. We could be stuck in a basement having to do office work all day long, and that would not.
That is true. That is true.
How's everybody doing in the chat, you guys? Yeah. How's the weather where you're at?
People from all over.
We got a good crew today. Look at that. Wow.
Hey, Renee from Houston. I'm in Houston, too.
What do they call H-Town? Woo.
H-Town, the 713. I was born on July 13th in the 713. Oh. I'm Houston through and through.
Wow. Yeah, there's some numbers. Numerology?
Numerology. Mm-hmm.
Good stuff. We'll let some folks drop in and give their feedback. It's hot, Teresa. Yeah, it's hot everywhere. Sunny Florida is probably humid.
85 degrees in Cleveland. Hey, Dan. Hi, Teresa. And Mo.
Wow, we've got India representing and Egypt representing. Look at that.
65-ish. Ugh. What's that like?
That must be up in a mountainy area or something.
I need to move.
Well, welcome to Idiotic, everybody. It's another Wednesday. I'm feeling a little lonely. Like I said, Chris is having Canada Day, as are all of the dominKnow employees. The office shuts down. It's their holiday. You know, we're waiting for Saturday. Well, we get Friday off, right? So those of us that work from home and you know, consult and do all of that probably still work on Friday, but that sort of is, it's the life we've chosen as rugged L&D professionals trying to make a living. So that's what we're going to talk about today, because Nyla is relatively new to L&D, not totally, but has done a fantastic job of building her career, at least from my perspective. But let's hear a little bit about who you are and a little bit about your past. I know everybody met you a couple weeks ago when we did our special on racial justice in L&D. But give us the regular rundown, sort of a career perspective.
Okay, sure. Well, hi, everyone. I'm Nyla. Like he said, I'm like halfway an accidental ID, but it was kind of intentional as well. But I started as a social media PR person, and I decided that that was fun when I was doing it for myself, but I didn't love it as much when I was doing it as a job. So I decided to go back to school for organization development. And then discovered instructional design. Just, it was a class that I took. And it was literally one of the hardest classes I've ever taken. And I think that's because I had a great teacher that really challenged us. And I enjoyed that challenge and discovering things I'd never heard about. And then I took an e-learning class right after that. And I was like, all right, this is the career for me. And it totally changed my life and my trajectory. And that's why I'm really passionate about sharing it with people and how to get it, break into the field, because I think getting in there is the tricky part sometimes. And so I like to just share with people how I got started and mentor them in the career part of ID, not just the theory, but like, how do I get a job? What does that look like? What are all these job titles? What do they mean? And so I've worked for companies with 50,000 employees, and I've worked for companies with 2 employees. And over time. My role, my job titles have changed, but I decided that what I call myself can be consistent. And so while I might be an instructional designer or a curriculum developer or whatever, I consider myself a learning experience designer, and that's the path I want to stick to.
Yeah, that term is becoming more and more popular. It's a little bit more of an umbrella term, right? It kind of bundles in all of the things that we end up talking about. You know, unless you really like to specialize in the tech side, you go with the e-learning title probably most of the time. If you don't think of yourself too much as a techie, you're way into more of the design and the analysis and thinking through, you know, what the content's going to be and who the audience is and all of that, then you lean more towards, I want to be an instructional designer kind of thing. But when you can wrap all those skills together, that's when the learning experience designer title, I think, fits really nicely.
Yeah. And I didn't have the language for it before, like a year and a half ago. I just knew that I wasn't doing only front end analysis, and I wasn't doing only e-learning development. I was working as an end-to-end designer. But I'm also like, I call myself a digital tinkerer. I like learning. I'm not formally trained in any kind of coding or anything, but I like figuring it out. And so when I discovered LXD, I was like, oh, you know, I keep seeing this term. Do I fit into that? Do I qualify as that? And as I learned more about it, I was like, well, I think this perfectly explains my evolution in learning and development.
Yeah, it's super nice. You know, there's another term coming around. We're hopefully going to have a conversation in September-ish about it, is learning engineer. Mm. And it's actually, there's a whole group of people coming together. It's being supported by IEEE. Mm-hmm. And they're trying to come up with a standard for an actual legit government title of a job called learning engineer. And yeah, we'll talk more about that later, but it's a, apparently it's a struggle because it says they want it to be what you just mentioned, right? It's a collection of all of that stuff, but there's two camps, right? There's the tech camp and then there's the instructional design camp, and one kind of is struggling for more.
I just know one more title to stress out the newbies.
I know. Well, that's the hardest part, right? Especially when you're looking for a job. So let's maybe roll into that for a little bit for anybody that's new. When you're looking and doing searches, right? So we've mentioned a couple phrases to search for, right? There's instructional designer, there's curriculum developer, learning experience design is popping up quite a bit now, and HR professionals and recruiters are starting to, you know, understand that that's part of the puzzle. Was there any other terms that you looked for or that you think would be helpful?
When I was searching, I was looking for e-learning developer, specifically when I first started. And then I was looking at instructional designer, and that was my last title, was senior instructional designer. But I was doing a lot of development. So I tell people, like, even the job title isn't going to really help you. You need to really dig into that description, and even email a recruiter or whoever is responsible for the job description and ask questions beforehand, because you don't want to end up thinking you're doing e-learning development and they just want you to do only front-end analysis or vice versa. Because you might end up in a position where you're like, this is not what I wanted to do.
Yeah. And, you know, I think that's the struggle for me, not to derail us too much, but I've actually been thinking about this a lot lately, and it's what the businesses need people to do and what we as professionals want to do for them doesn't necessarily match.
No, there's a real large gap there. And it's different. If you have a learning organization in a company that's led by somebody in L&D, then there might be some more clarity there. But I've noticed if it's an organization that where you would be the only instructional designer, or they just know they need to build a learning program, then, you know, that might be a little more fuzzy about your responsibilities. And you end up doing the jobs of six people versus one person. So.
Right, right. Well, I can remember when I was in school, I remember one of my teachers explaining that, you know, you should look for tech writer jobs because that's kind of what we do too. You know, you should be able to go in, and most of the time those tech writers are writing educational instructional content as well. So you guys are more than qualified to apply for those jobs. And I thought, well, that's kind of weird. Why, you know, why are we taking the tech writers' jobs? I thought we were different.
Yeah. Yeah. And I see a lot of tech writers now transitioning into ID.
Tech writing has kind of gone, you know, the big conferences that used to exist just for tech writers, the software that used to exist for tech writers, all just kind of going away or blending into other software. Boy, that's a whole nother conversation we could probably talk about. Let's take this a little bit chronologically and go from, so you mentioned you had that cool class in L&D and then you took an e-learning class. Then what was sort of the next step? You've been bitten by the bug. You're excited about it. And what's that first step? What did you think you had to do next?
Well, I was already working for a video production company and they did training videos. And so I was actually going to leave, because I was like, okay, I need to get a job in L&D. I need to get a big fancy job at some corporation. And she was like, well, I don't want you to leave. So let's work something out. And she actually helped me source some of my first freelance clients. Now I'm fresh out of school and I don't know anything. I know how to build something in Storyline 2 and that is it. And so I got a really big client right out the gate through this partnership with the video production company. And I cut my teeth on that project. That project was really hard. And I learned about dealing with SMEs and consulting clients and so much. And to make a long story short, I ran to corporate. I ran away from freelance for a while because it's tricky. And so I really respect people that are freelance e-learning developers and IDs because building out your own infrastructure is not easy. After I spent time there, I got absorbed into oil and gas.
Ah, well, being from Houston, I imagine that that's a big...
Yeah, in Houston, you're either a medical L&D professional or oil and gas L&D professional.
You know, it would be interesting. This just popped into my mind. I saw a YouTube video the other day. They were talking about some research that was in different states, and they had a different word that popped up the most for each one of the states. It'd be interesting to see in each one of the big cities, if you're in L&D, what are the big companies that you're likely to work for? What are the big companies in each one of the big cities that do have a tendency to hire instructional designers? That might make an interesting infographic.
Oh, yeah.
If anybody wants to do that and share it with us, that would be awesome.
Or even if it's in the chat, if you know offhand, like I know oil and gas and medical is big here in Houston. What's big in wherever you're from? That would be interesting.
I would guess Silicon Valley is software.
Right. Yes, I was going to mention, we were talking about LXD as a job title. I've seen mostly tech companies really welcoming that job title with open arms, a learning experience designer.
Yep. Yeah, there were a couple other ones that were dropped in up at the top. I'm scrolling up here real quick, and I noticed Craig Seibert put in L&D professional, the standard, you know, that works. And Mo had a great one too. Learning architect. I hear that a lot. And I see that a lot as well, which is nice. Joe Suarez dropped that in too. So lots of different ways to describe it. So but one of the other things, as we sort of get down to about the 20-minute mark here, one of the things I noticed about you right away, and one of the first ways I was introduced to you, was the first time I saw you on LinkedIn and you popped up into my feed somehow. And I thought, oh, here's a girl that's got her social media stuff together. How did you do that? I mean, you built a really cool little personal brand for yourself, and it looked like you did it so well. I thought, oh, she strategized this somehow. She thought this through. This is good.
Yeah. So, my background is in PR and social media. So I did my first podcast in 2008. And I didn't feel like anybody was listening to them back then. they blew up pretty. The evolution of podcasts is interesting, but, I used to blog and write for my own lifestyle brand. And I stopped that a while ago, but I like it. I like content creation. And I was like, well, why don't I start combining my love for instructional design and learning and development with my passion for just creating stuff. So I started a 30-day challenge last year to post every day on LinkedIn, because that was one social media platform I never really conquered. And, but really my motivation behind it is, that I know in this day and age, I have to create my own job security. And, while I am loyal to the companies that I work for, I know that my name is what carries me through and the work that I show. So that's why I was really committed to doing that. And it's really not that difficult. It was just consistency. That's all.
Yeah. But you know what? A lot of people just don't know that. I mean, you come from that PR and that social media side of it, right? So it kind of comes easy to you. But one of the things that I've found is that, you know, so and this applies to a lot of different industries, but, you know, the things that we do that we take for granted, I think sometimes are the things that we know, and we just kind of assume that everybody else knows too. And you'd be surprised how many people would be like, oh, they're going to listen to that and go, oh, consistency. That's interesting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I need to have a plan. You mean I need to actually work at this? I can't just jump on to LinkedIn and just say, hey, howdy, how's everybody doing?
Yeah. And it's like, I had a content calendar and all that at first, and then I was like, I don't need that anymore. You know, I just have to promise myself, okay, I kind of figured out that if I post on Mondays, that can take me through the whole week. And I've listened to people on LinkedIn who've helped, John Marty and Tim Salau. I'll drop their names in the chat, but they're good people to follow if you're trying to figure out how to navigate LinkedIn. And yeah, it's just, that's also changed my life, because I didn't know there was this community before of L&D professionals that is a fantastic community. And so without getting on LinkedIn and being a part of it, I would not have met any of you. I would not have gotten the help. I would not have become a better designer. So on top of building my brand, I've become a better professional. And I think sometimes people are like, I know it seems like I'm extroverted and all that. I'm really not. Very much an introvert. But I think some people are weary of being vocal online for lots of different reasons. And I don't think it's for everyone. You don't have to do it at all. But there's a social contract that we all have with each other that I'm going to give to you, and I'll put in more than I expect, but I know that I can rely on the community. And so community building online is exciting to me for that reason.
Yeah, for sure. And I think, you know, again, I think that's another thing that we kind of take for granted. People look, in the early days, it was kind of the wild, wild west, right? If you were doing podcasting in 2008, you were definitely an early adopter. But you remember those times, right? I guess in 2008, there were probably social media gurus and professionals popping up and all that kind of stuff. But I can remember when there were no rules for any of this stuff, you know, pre-2005. Everybody was just kind of doing their own thing, and everybody was trying to figure it out and just communicate. Everybody was just enjoying the fact that the internet had shifted from a one-way place where you go to just consume information to a place where now you could share information and people would share back. And now it's a two-way conversation on this big thing called the internet. I mean, I think that transition kind of happened so fast. A lot of people forget how revolutionary that was, and the fact that now, you know, 20 years later, we're here on video talking to each other and have a crowd of 100 people hanging out with us, chatting in a chat box. You know, it's all pretty darn amazing. But to circle this back around to L&D, right? One of the reasons why I love to do this kind of stuff is that I start to think about it from an L&D perspective. How do we use tools like this for learning and development and whatnot? And describing yourself as a tinkerer, I get a suspicion that you do the same thing with the tech you play around with.
I'm really I try not to be a bandwagoner. I know that we get excited by new things, but I'm all for early adoption. Like, let me figure it out from the beginning, and then grow with whatever platform it is. I think that's important too. So yeah, I like new stuff. I like the new shiny stuff.
All right. So here's a good one. So are you experimenting with TikTok?
Okay. So TikTok, I was repeatedly at the beginning of the year. I'm going to get a little deep here. I don't feel like it's always a psychologically safe space for me as a Black woman. And maybe that's where the people who pop on my main feed. So I kind of step back from it for a while. But I'm thinking about going back. It's just like, it's just a lot to, to take the time and film stuff for that. And I know how to create content and then break it apart several different platforms. But even that is, it's like adding TikTok to it. But I had it when I had it back in the day when it was Musical.ly and people were just karaokeing. And so seeing the evolution of what it is now, I'm like, what is going on here? But TikTok for learning is very interesting. I'm excited to see where that goes. And I know somebody who's developing a proprietary micro learning platform that's similar to TikTok. It's called Guide, and I'm excited to check that out too.
Oh, awesome. Yeah. So if there's any sort of like beta that we can all get in with,
there is a beta for Guide.
We're happy to help always. Looks like we got a bunch of early adopters in the house too. Wendy's dropping in. Yep. We love the early adopters. Being an early adopter is very painful, though. You take all the arrows and you take all the abuse. I can remember, this is me going back. Kara North isn't here, but you can tell her that I said back in the day, when Twitter first came out, I was literally laughed at on stage at an event giving a presentation on the power of social media and learning. But back in the day, we called it Learning 2.0. And I was giving lots of presentations at the time because it was so new. And I was talking about Twitter. And oh my, did people really not think Twitter was going to do anything? They thought it was the dumbest thing in the world. And I know, right? And it's just like every day I wake up, I look at Twitter and I'm like, you know, I wish there was a bigger platform where I could say I told you so. But
there's, it's strange. Those people always go very quiet later. They laugh at you first.
Trust me. I know all of the people in our industry that gave me grief for being all into Twitter in the early days. And I don't let them forget. Oh, funny. So, okay, so let's get back a little bit to you do some really cool things in helping other people get into L&D because, you know, of what you know and the experiences you've had and all of that. Tell us a little bit about that.
Sure. So I set a goal to mentor 100 Black and other women of color enter L&D in the next 5 years. I don't know why I picked that number. I was just like, that sounds good. It's a good round number. And so I've been working on that for the last year. I'm 1 year into that. And I'm about to kick off a mentorship cohort today, actually, with a group of 20 women looking to get into L&D. And yeah, we're just going to talk about, like I said earlier, the career part of it all. So it's like, I call it gap insurance or group therapy. Like, let's talk about your woes and getting into the industry, what you're confused about, what you just need some mentorship on, or even sponsorship as well. How can I really vouch for you and get you up to speed on everything? And then on top of that, we've got the recent development of Design by Humanity. I think I've got some people in the group here from that. And that was born out of what's happening in our country right now. We really wanted to initially create social justice topics, learning experiences rather, use our skills as IDs to fight racism. And it's evolved into something even greater. We've got over 300 designers signed up who either want to mentor or be mentored and create real world projects. And we're just doing something great there. And if you want to find out more, I can drop the link in the chat about Design by Humanity. But yeah, just really passionate about helping people get into the industry.
Well, yeah, feel free to drop the link in. And if there's somebody else that's participating that has the link available, they can do it too. So don't be afraid to drop links in the chat, folks. It's okay. I mean, unless you're going to go out and, you know, promote products and stuff like that. But, you know, if it's pertinent to our conversation, absolutely share.
Yeah, yeah. And I also have a podcast for new instructional designers. It's a mini cast. All episodes are less than 20 minutes.
And fantastic, I will say. Very well done.
Yeah, you know? I just talk about the most basic, it's a primer, so it's just about the most basic elements of getting into the industry. So, you know, job titles, what is the difference between an e-learning developer and instructional designer, if there is a difference in your mind, all sorts of topics like that. So,
Well, you know what? Let's geek out just for a minute, because we can't like get to the end of the show and not geek out on some tech stuff. So I think this would be a good little segue. What do you use to record and produce your podcast?
Okay,
like your
sure.
Microphone, your like what apps do you use? All that kind of stuff.
So I want to tell you guys that I kicked off my podcast for like less than $20. So the initial investment was nothing. Well, to me, I mean, $20 is $20. Don't get me wrong. But
hey, I'll pick it up off the street if I see a $20 bill.
Yeah, but it wasn't like $100 or $500. Yeah, so I use the Anchor app. It's A-N-C-H-O-R, which I have used for a couple other podcasts. It's free to use. Completely. You can even make money from it if you include a sponsored ad. You could start doing that right away, no matter your listenership. I use that to distribute my podcast. I record into Audacity for free as well. And then I edit in, before I got my Camtasia license, I was editing in, oh my gosh, what is it called? Give me a second. It's free. You guys know. Somebody knows. No, not Audacity. I was editing in DaVinci Resolve. That's what it's called.
Oh, is that free too?
Yeah, there's a free version of that. But yeah. It's kind of the learning curve on DaVinci Resolve is a little higher. So I prefer just getting in and out with Camtasia because I'm more familiar with that interface. And my mic was $5 from Five Below, if you guys know what Five Below is. But I've upgraded now. And yeah, that was it. So the mic and the app and Audacity, less than $20. I bought my domain name. That was it. It takes me a little while to do it because I do script things out and it's just me. I'm not going to have guests on this first season of the podcast. So the main investment is time. That's it.
Awesome.
Yeah.
We always like that. What kind of mic did you buy? Let's get into that.
So this is the mic I have. It's called a Toner, T-O-N-O-R. And I got it from Amazon, and the mic itself, I think, is $35. And then I got an arm. So in total is about 70. And that's the only other, that's the only upgrade I've done so far.
Awesome.
Yeah. And the sound, I had a $5 mic before and I can tell the difference, but the $5 mic did the job. So
yeah, so I can drop a little nugget in that I was super excited about last week. There was an app that I used to use all the time. So I was doing podcasts back in 2006, I think it was, when it first kind of started popping. And there was an app called Levelator. that could take your audio. You just drag and drop. The only thing it did, like my, some of my favorite apps in the world are the ones that do one thing and they do them really, really well.
Yeah.
And you could take your audio file that was recorded with multiple mics or whatever, and maybe one volume was really low on one mic and the other one was really high, whatever. You just drag and drop this file right onto that icon on your laptop and it processes it and just levels everything out and makes it really nice and even. And they stopped developing it a few years back, probably 10 years ago. Well, it's back. Somebody, because it was open source, and so somebody picked it back up, and I think it's Mac only though. It's in the and now it's, they just put it into the app store.
So it's a desktop, it's a desktop app,
or it's also a desktop app. Yes,
that is called great.
I will say, very cool.
One thing that is tricky to figure out that I think I'd like to learn more about in L&D is audio in general. We mess with audio so much, and there's kind of a learning curve with getting audio perfect. And so I would love to, if anybody is an audio expert and would like to talk to my cohort about audio, I would like to invite you to join, to come talk to us, because I'd like a crash course in that. Luckily, my partner is a videographer, so he helps me a little. He helped me figure out that I don't have to buy the most expensive mic, just what the requirements needed. And he helps me a little with my audio if I have some questions about levels, or like, do I need to add some more treble or bass in this? So that's helpful.
Nice. Yeah, I'm sure some of you have, if you've gone back and listened to the Crowdcast archive of this show, you'll probably notice that there's some differences in the audio that coming into the app. And Crowdcast does a fantastic job of trying to get everything equalized out. But this is the perfect example. If you're also using Crowdcast or some other tool where you've got multiple sound signals coming in, to drop it in there and just to level it all out is cool. So that's my app tip of the day for
that's
folks.
A good one, Levelator.
And we've got a lot of audio video professionals and experts in the house today. I see Craig Seibert. I see obviously Dan Kekin knows a thing or two about video and whatnot. Ketzel Coat is video extraordinaire genius and equally of audio fame. So there are tons of folks that would be happy to chat with your cohorts. I can send you a list, or you know, whatever you however you want to do it. If somebody wants to reach out,
I'll drop my LinkedIn too in the chat here.
Yeah, for sure. I'm sure somebody would be very, very happy to help your cohort and participate in that learning for sure. Yeah. And so what's next for Nyla? So you're new, you're ramping this up. I can't even really call you new anymore. I mean, you've got some experience under your belt. You're mentoring other people and whatnot. I just thought it was kind of cool to have you on because your newness is still kind of fresh, even though you may be stepping out of being new. It's relatively a fresh experience for you.
So because I do spend a lot of time talking about fundamentals with like people I mentor, I have to be really intentional about upskilling and like moving my career forward. And so that's what I've been focusing on lately, trying to plan out what I want to do next. I mean, I had a good manager who was willing to develop me. And, you know, she said, you know, you don't want to be an e-learning developer forever. And I was like, I don't. I really had to sit with that and be like, oh, do I not? So figuring out what I want to do next is figuring out what I want to do next. But I am freelancing right now, and I'm enjoying the getting back into that. I know more now, and it's made me a better consultant. So I'm venturing back into that right now.
Very cool. Yeah. It takes a while to get used to that. I sort of got dumped into that consulting thing a little early too. And I went into it totally blind and did all the things wrong, and it scared me away too. And I went running back to a corporate gig for a long time and then jumped back out into it and felt much more well-equipped
yeah.
to to handle, you know, consulting, contracting, all that kind of stuff. You know, it is not an easy road to follow for sure. But what do you hear, just as we will wrap it up here with a final question? I'm curious to know, it sounds like you've got a lot of folks really interested in your cohort and a lot of people reaching out. You know, what is the average person like? What is it? What do they look like when they come to you? Where do they come from? Right. And what interests them? What does the typical person saying, "Ooh, this looks interesting. I want to get involved. I want to be a newbie in L&D. You know, what is the personality makeup of somebody like that?
A lot of people transitioning from education, or like they've been in proximity to L&D, but not directly in it. And so they're trying to figure out how to break in. I actually have a lot of people I talk to that have been through boot camps, or they have degrees and they've had them for a while and they just can't get a job. And so I usually tell them, they're like, okay, I need to learn this, this, then this to finally get the job. And I have to explain that it's not your lack of knowledge that might be keeping you away. I think it's just how maybe you're packaging yourself when you are applying, or maybe you're not, you know, you're not leveraging your network. Maybe people don't fully understand what kind of job you actually want. So let's work to repackage that for you. And so it's usually little things. It's usually not a lack of skill or knowledge at all. And so that's mostly who's coming to talk to me.
Yeah. You know what? Isn't that just that's just the answer to everything these days, right? It's never a training problem, right? The business comes to you and they say, "We need training on this." And you're like, "Are you sure it's a training problem? Does it have anything to do with skills or knowledge?" No. Well, why? It's not a training problem.
Exactly. Exactly. It's just clarify how you're communicating what you want to do, you know, and that's hard, because sometimes you're like, "Well, I thought I wanted to do this, but the job title says this." So I get it. It's tricky.
Yeah. And it's very interesting to hear that. And, you know, it's good to always be reminded of that, because I think there is a conversational bubble that exists in our industry where people forget that there are a lot of newbies and a lot of new folks coming into the industry, and they're going to ask questions or they're going to say things that, you know, the greater you, not you, but you know, that everybody that's out there having these conversations is, you know, you may look at it and think, why are they saying that? And a lot of people, I think, especially on social media, have a tendency to jump on people right away and say, "That's, why would you say that? What's wrong?" And forget, hey, whoa, dial back. Maybe the person's new. Maybe they, you know, they don't know that learning styles, and they haven't heard of the Mythbusters in our industry yet. And, you know, go easy on them.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, we were all new and doe-eyed. I'm still like, I just posted this morning that there's so much I don't know. And I think that's exciting. And I have to remind myself of that too, because I don't want to be a know-it-all and position myself as that I have all the answers. I don't at all. There's so much I'm still learning from everybody, but that's why I'm like, I was hesitant at first to consider myself a mentor. And then I was like, I can share what I've learned so far and help people. So, and be comfortable with that.
Well, I think that's why you make a great mentor, because all of these things are super fresh and you remember what it was like, and you know that, you know, like you said, you don't know everything. And heck, none of us do. I think that's what I always tell people all the time, is that it's just changing all the time. That's kind of the fun about being in the career. It's like something you did, you know, 12 months ago for one company, you probably wouldn't do the same thing again.
Yeah.
Because there's new tech, or there's, you know, you've learned something from that company or from a new client. And you're like, "Ooh, well, back 2 years ago, I should have done this for them," you know?
Yeah. And people ask me questions and I'm always saying, "Well, it depends." And I know that annoys them, but I'm like, my job isn't going to be the same as the one you get. So I could tell you what my experience was, but yours might be so different.
Yeah. Well, I think that's why networks like this are so important. In any network that you get into related to the field, there's a ton out there. And just being connected with others in the industry is so incredibly important you know, to succeed. And I just wanted to just really recap and focus on what you just said to folks about marketing yourself and packaging yourself and letting your community know the type of work you want to do. That just to highlight that real quick, is it really is super important. I tell people all the time, all of the best jobs I've ever had came from people that I knew in my network, mm-hmm. or people mm-hmm. that knew me, people that reached out to me and said, mm-hmm. hey, you're available. You know, do you want to come work for us? Mm-hmm. You know, that kind of thing. All the best ones. I've had some not so best jobs, and those were the ones that I got because I applied and I went through the process, you know, and mm-hmm. all of that. And I just found out that, no, this is not kind of what I signed on for. This is not the gig. Yeah. But the best ones come from your network and knowing people and having people understand what you want and what you do.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah. And it's not, I think people are afraid of, it's just who you knew. It wasn't your skill. And that's not what we mean at all. It's just leveraging your network and also, keeping your skills up to par.
You got to think about it from the aspect of the hiring person, right? Mm-hmm. When you're out there and you're looking for somebody to hire, the first thing you think about is, who do I know that does this? Mm-hmm. It's not, mm-hmm. how do I write a good, LinkedIn opening thing?
Yeah. Because it's just easier the path of least resistance is to hire someone who you know can do the work. So I understand it. And that's why when people are so focused on an ATS compliant resume, I'm like, that's great, but please don't just submit it and then walk away. Like, you got to do some footwork.
We'll have to do another show specifically on hiring and going through that process, because boy, I've got some battle scars.
I just released a podcast episode about that, you guys. I'm going to do a part two on the hiring process, because there are ways that people are hacking this. And that's why when you apply online and you hear nothing for months and then you get a rejection email months later. And I really want to talk about how to hack it, because it's just what you don't know. It's not hard. It's just what you don't know.
Oh, wow. Here's a great question. And we're already at the 7:45 mark, but I think this is good enough to stick around for a while. If everybody that's on doesn't mind. Lori asks, do you suggest using your real name and or a moniker, for example, Nuggethead, aka Kevin Thorne?
Well, I wonder, like, in what context do you mean? So I use Nyla LXD is my main portfolio website. I also own nylaspooner.com, but it kind of points to Nyla LXD. I don't think it's bad to have a moniker at all, if people know that it's you and what you do when you do it. So it depends on what your moniker is and where you don't put that on your I don't know, you could put it on your resume. It just depends what your brand is. It really depends on what your brand is.
I think if you're looking for corporate work, I think it might turn people off, because people associate a moniker or a brand with a company, right? And you're building a consultancy or something like that. Mm-hmm. And corporations might look at that and go, maybe they're not going to be all that engaged working for us, because they kind of have their own thing going mm-hmm. with this brand. But if your brand is just your name, then everybody totally understands that. Oh, they're marketing themselves really well, and doing it. So I think you're right. I think it depends. Again.
Yeah. Yeah.
mm-hmm. For sure. Well, any parting words of wisdom for newbies before we go?
Oh, there's so much. I always tell people to craft your instructional design philosophy, because it will help you define, how you want to present yourself to the L&D world. And so when I say philosophy, I don't mean you have to go out and write your own model, your own L&D model. I just mean you need to be clear about how you pitch yourself to people. to employers, to your network, so that they understand what you, who you are, what you do, and what you want to do.
Awesome. Perfect way to wrap this up today, Nyla. Thank you so much for hanging out with me today.
Thanks for having me back on. I like being here.
Yeah, good. So we will absolutely have you back. And it's been kind of lonely without Chris. Chris, if you're listening, we miss you. We'll see you next week for sure. I hope I did as well today.
You did a good job.
Oh, thank you.
I didn't even notice Chris was missing. No, sorry, Chris.
Oh, man. All right. So cool. So drop your links in, your URL, where people can find you, the LinkedIn link, all that kind of good stuff. Folks, we've got another great show for you next week as well. Oops, I forgot to kind of kick off the We're Leaving Now music. And and don't forget, I forgot to tell everybody while the music is slowly coming in for us and as we're having our dance out, don't forget, Megan Torrance just did a blog post and I didn't grab the link ahead of time, but she's got a great resource of graphic images that she just posted about. If somebody can find that link really fast and drop it in for me, that would be fantastic. But if not, just go find Megan Torrance on LinkedIn and look at her stream and all of her information and whatnot. And you can find all those free graphics that all the graphics companies and whatnot. Domino did a whole collection of free graphics for our user base as well. So that's in there. There's a whole bunch of great, great stuff out there. Lots of companies stepping up and doing some cool stuff for everything that's going on and for building, you know, race relations, understanding, all of that. So anyways, I'm looking forward to seeing what everybody comes up with and what Design by Humanity comes up with. Thanks again, Nyla.
Thank you. Bye, everyone.
Bye, everybody. Take care. Everybody can dance out and I will do my final Zoom. Here, let's get the logo this way. And if you haven't received the mug yet, Nyla, it's in the mail.
Oh, yeah, I need a mug.
It's on its way.
Okay.
One of these days we'll upgrade the cool special effects, but for now that's all you guys get. See everybody. Have a great day. We'll see you next week.
Bye.